Superintendent recommends the committee accept the secretary's report of the executive session of the committee of July 7th, 2011.
So moved. Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Carrera and seconded by Ms. White. Is there any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
Sorry, I have to abstain from the executive session because I was not here.
Please record that.
So you might need another second.
I'll second that.
So the motion is seconded by Mr. Souza. We'll revote on the minutes of the executive session. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
Aye.
Ms. White abstains. It's unanimous. On the agenda, we have an executive session scheduled. We have not had any negotiation sessions since our last meeting. And so the question is whether we really need to go into executive session this evening for the purpose of discussing collective bargaining. I would be inclined not to proceed to executive session. Does anyone disagree?
I agree with that.
So in the absence of a motion to enter executive session, we'll continue with our agenda. The next item on the agenda is public input. Is there any public input this evening?
I still say we should not build this school because the economy is going downhill. And, you know, we're losing houses. You're going to lose jobs. Who's going to pay for it if Berkley cannot pay for this bill? That's my honest opinion. Is the state going to come up and say, hey, we're going to give you the money or what?
Well, thank you for that input, Mr. Brown. And ordinarily, I wouldn't respond, except that I feel compelled to say that in my observation, the people of Berkley have been stand up in this whole process and have wholeheartedly supported it and gone to the polls and voted the funding necessary to proceed with the process. So hopefully the citizens of both communities will remain very supportive of the project. All right, let's proceed to old business. First item under old business is a budget update. I know that Mrs. Naraki had asked that some issues regarding the budget be placed on the agenda, but since she isn't here this evening, I think I'll ask the superintendent to provide a budget update, and if anyone else has any other issues, we can entertain those.
Yeah, I mean, it's a pretty brief, we provided the FinStat report, the monthly report. I think that should be a continued practice. The interim business manager is not here tonight, but I certainly speak of that you saw the warrants that have been placed, the monies that are available. Mr. Pierce and I had a brief discussion about, as we look forward with the project manager and some bills that may come, the fact that monies are available. I've had a lengthy discussion with the treasurer, and I think we are very well prepared to handle that initial wave as they come through, as some of these activities start to certainly ratchet up. And I probably talk a little more in detail at the building committee. I'll try to give you some capital project plans. I know we're going to talk about the old building, so I'll give you some updates when we get down to the building committee portion of that. In addition, I'll try to bring forward anything that might be kind of out of the ordinary as it relates to monthly type of pieces. And even in that FinStat report, which I've had my dialogue with certainly Somerset members, are sometimes that report, unless something's highlighted, can get lost in the shuffle of the pages. So I think between myself and the business manager, we'll try to highlight a specific actions and our activities or expenditures that might take place. There's not a whole lot in that, as you saw in relation to that, but I feel very comfortable that the budget that we have in place right now, kind of moving forward, obviously it's very early in the year, but is right on target and is moving smoothly. We had our first payroll coming around, the second payroll, so I think it's a very good start for the region in relation to that piece. I know some of the other items that are going to come up a little bit later as it relates to, you know, transportation reimbursement, things are also very promising as it relates to our budget. But that's kind of the quick overview. Mr. DeLude, the business manager will be here on our August 11th meeting in relation to that, so we can give you some more specifics, and we certainly have another monthly update.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I had also said budget update, just in as far as topics that I think I would like to look at as a board member going forward, and maybe looking at how, not, I know it's early on, we just got through the budget process, but how do we present that budget in the upcoming fiscal year? How do we format it so we, it's very easy to understand for all our constituents? And so I wanted to kind of approach that as a subject that we look forward to and work on during the coming months.
So you're looking for a different format than?
Yeah, maybe a different presentation format. It's not exactly the forms that we use now, but a different way of presenting it. A different process for presenting it, more collaborative process. I see that later on in the agenda, we talk about collaboration. I don't know if it's in line of this, but to kind of go out there and really explain to all the different groups, the FinCom, ANF, Selectmen early on, what the budget is proposed, what is the income, what is the expenses associated with it, so that we, coming from the other side, from the ANF side, I would like to see a clearer picture when it's presented to me of what the needs of the district. So I think I can bring a different perspective as to how that goes.
Anyone else? Any comments?
The only that, in regards to the budget, what I had in, I don't know if it's on here or not, but in one of the subcommittees, I think you can form as a subcommittee budget. And what we did, what I did when I was on the finance committee, what we did with the school department in Berkeley to do the regionalization things, that we put together a sort of a spreadsheet of expenses, revenues, and we broke it down to every department, every expense, and you can put it in a neat way with graphs and stuff like that, so you can explain people with spreadsheet-wise of where the expenses go, what they're paid for, how they get here, and you can project over the years, past and future, where you intend to go with it as well. So that was a part of the subcommittee. I don't know if Julie wants to do it, but what I did is I just crunched all the numbers and I put it, give it to someone who can put it into a computer format. And it does a great job with it. It's nice software and you can show people where the budgets are, where the expenses go, and where you can get pulled again.
Do we update any subcommittee?
No, we haven't as yet. I think we need to handle that at a meeting soon. But.
Okay. I did have a question on the budget, if I may. I was just wondering, Christine Lynch from Department of Ed had been notified, and maybe I'm jumping ahead. I know that Berkeley had written a letter and forwarded it to Christine Lynch, but we had a letter from Jeff Wilson stating when the votes were taken out of both towns to approve the budget numbers. Please forward to him or notify him in some way, because right now we're working with that one. So, has that been done yet?
That was faxed to him.
Right, right.
Yeah, that was
so
done.
Was,
yeah.
All right. Yeah. Okay. So, is he going to be sending another letter stating?
I don't think we're receiving anything. I don't believe there's anything else that. I mean, I can follow up with Jeff if you'd like, but we did immediately send that information, okay. Notification. I think we're fine.
I actually had a conversation with Dr. Hemmen last week. He called me. I think to talk about something that had happened at the State House that day, and he mentioned that the Department of Education expressed some concern about the effective date of the budget, because even though the Berkeley Selectmen had sent a letter indicating that they did not intend to call a special town meeting to reconsider the budget, that the Department of Education took the view that we had to wait 45 days, the 45 day period, because theoretically they could change their mind and call a meeting. So I think it's just a matter of waiting the 45 days from the date they were notified to have the budget actually considered to have been approved.
Do they need a follow-up 45 days after from the Berkeley Board of Selectmen to say no, it's been accepted, or are they just going to let it pass and then send us a response?
Why don't we leave it to Mr. Medeiros to inquire of them and let us know at the next meeting as to whether any further follow-up is required. We have several items under old business, and since this defense maker is here to talk about building committee business, we might consider taking the items under the building committee up at this time. Would anyone care to make a motion to do that?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion by Mr. Souza, seconded by Mrs. Ferrer to consider the building committee agenda items at this time. Any discussion?
I'd just like to say, from my perspective, that to give a great thanks to the building committee, who I know worked incredibly hard and put a lot of work into getting the time constraints down. So I just think it was phenomenal. I went to one of the presentations, actually the one that was adopted. I just think it was an incredible job by the building committee to get this thing up and running and get the design plan approved and voted on in such a short period of time. And obviously time is an essence of interest rates, and it affects obviously the cost of all this. So I just want to say a great job to the chairman and all the members of the building committee, doing a phenomenal job of getting this done in a timely and a very thorough fashion.
So in the absence of further discussion, we'll vote on moving these agenda items up. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Unanimous. All right, so Mr. Fenstermaker, I'm going to take up the issue of a vote to allow the building committee to enter contract negotiations with AI3 Architects. Perhaps as an introduction to that issue, you could provide us with the update on the new building.
Certainly. Thank you. And thank you for the kind words, Mr. Kelly. I'll just say that we have a very dedicated and a great building committee, and I just happen to get my name on a lot of things, but they're really working hard on it. As all of you know, and most of you attended at least one or some, in some cases, both interviews, both nights of interviews with designers, and from the interviews and after considering, you know, how the model schools would fit our program of studies and our site layout, the building committee chose AI3 as the designer of choice for the new Somerset Berkley Regional High School. So procedurally, that was at our meeting of the 20th of July, last Wednesday. So procedurally, I think that we would be bringing to you recommendation to get the regional school committee's authorization to move forward with a contract with AI3 and to begin negotiations on that contract. That's the main agenda item for me tonight, to see if we can have a motion to move forward with the contract negotiation for the AI3 and accept them as the designer of choice.
Are there any before we consider a motion, are there any questions from any members of the committee to Mr. Fenstermaker about the process?
Could you just explain the process a little bit about negotiating as an entire board, or do?
Well, that's the negotiation, I think, would be the entire board would approve it. The negotiation for this, the fees are pretty well set by the MSBA. The contract is pretty well set. It's, I forget, it's like a 30-page contract. Yeah. You know, it's a really extensive contract. And the fees are pretty well set. And actually, we have a fee proposal that we received, and the project manager and I have not had a chance to go through it yet. We sent it to the MSBA. But the MSBA guidelines, as I understand it, are typically between 4 and 4.5% of the project for the fees associated with this assignment. The numbers we have now look to be on the low end of that range. Again, we've got to kind of go through them a little bit more. So the intent would be, I think, with the committee's approval, for the project manager and I trying to negotiate down the fee and then come to the building committee with a recommendation at our meeting next week if we were able to do that, and subject to the MSBA approval.
Any other questions?
No, Mr. Chair, no questions, but definitely a comment on AI3 and their, I want to say, enthusiasm, I was going to say intense happiness for being part of this project with Somerset Berkley Regional. As you can see, they've already provided us in the backdrop over here of some of the projects that they've done prior to with Norwood, Plymouth North, Natick, and East Bridgewater. And some of the looks of the Norwood School, of how it used to look and how it is compared to with the new building, and the similarities to that. And also, you know, the concept of how the layout will be for our new building. And knowing the superintendent mentioned right before the meeting, and I think you can go a little bit further in detail, of AI3 already coming down and doing research on the project. Mr. Superintendent?
Yeah, per request of the chair, I'm a member of the building committee. We did have a kind of walk through a proposed space summary today, a pretty extensive piece, and I would agree, very enthusiastic. Two individuals, two partners from the firm came down, walked through with the current principal, Dr. Mosley, and also the most recent retired principal, Mr. Pinault, and myself, and we did a walk through and looking at existing space and potential proposed spaces. So very valuable walk through. I had left for another meeting about 11 o'clock, so they were about 2 hours in, and they still felt they had about another 20 minutes, another half hour session. So very productive, and I think they're absolutely right. I fully endorse and support this as well, kind of move forward.
And that the interesting thing about the space that you mentioned earlier, and I know there were some concerns that when they look at our space, and that's going to really be the focus of the initial steps here, is to get that, the educational space needs established and nailed down. And you know, as we've said on, or at least I've said on a number of occasions, that I think if we have programs and studies are established, we can fight for the space we need. And I think they indicated in that walkthrough that
there was a lot of evidence of that, that they felt very positive, that they felt, and certainly their lengthy experience with MSBA, showing existing programs and utilized space, educational space, is going to be invaluable kind of moving forward to justify proposed, you know, space as it relates to the model school, so.
And especially, I mean, one of them was, and I know it was your concern, Liz, was the music and arts. And they saw the amount of space that is utilized in our building now. So that's one of the things that, you know, they mentioned to the superintendent, that that's something we can try to pay for and try to, you know, accommodate, which is good.
Just a couple of thoughts. I noticed that in the model contract, Mr. Fenstermaker was kind enough to email me a copy of the sort of standard form of architect's contract that the SBA has. I didn't forward it on to the other members of the committee because it's many pages long, about 60 pages. And if anyone would like to have a copy, I think we'll have a copy of the final document when it's prepared and finalized. I'm sure that everyone has a copy of it at that point. But I did note the schedule of fees on the back that's being proposed, and I was wondering if we could get copies of the schedule of fees from East Bridgewater and the Natick projects. And also, I'd like to, perhaps for the building committee purposes, to have copies of the schematic designs for Natick and East Bridgewater. East Bridgewater struck me as something we should look at because, as I understand it, they're almost identical in size to our school. They have a student population of about 1,000.
Yeah. The East Bridgewater, the configuration may be a little bit different because it's a junior senior high school. And we can certainly get those.
Okay, so then it isn't a high school of 1,000.
No, they had to combine schools to get to the MSBA number for, as a high school alone, they couldn't get project approval.
So if there are no further questions on the issue of the AI3, the chair will entertain a motion to accept the recommendation of the building committee to designate AI3 Architects Model School and to authorize the building committee to enter into contract negotiations with AI3 to arrive at a final design contract.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliotti, seconded by Mr. Souza. Is there any further discussion? In the absence of discussion, the chair will call for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Unanimous. Okay. Mr. Fensenmaker, there is one other issue under this, that same item that I would like just talk briefly about. It's the building design planning process involving faculty and staff. I noted in the contract that when they talk about the various steps, the first step is the process of designing the educational space, and it actually says number one is developing a design program in accordance with the authority's guidelines to accommodate the owner's educational requirements. And as I indicated at the building committee meeting, my primary concern is to make sure that all of the voices are heard in the planning process in terms of the administration, our superintendent, our director of curriculum, our special ed director, and the administration at the high school, as well as faculty and certainly coordinators. So I was wondering if you've had any discussion as yet with the designers about that process.
Well, we are at, they have reiterated that their number one focus is going to be on that educational space plan. And at our meeting next Wednesday, the building committee meeting next Wednesday, AI3 will be here. It's kind of an introductory meeting. And part of that is going to be establishing how we're going to do that. What's the best way to do that? The question is going to be, I certainly want to involve as many people as possible from the staff and the administration. Logistically, bringing people in during the summer, I'm not sure when the content coordinators are available, the departments, if they would come in earlier rather than later, or come in for some focused meetings. My sense is that most of the people, you know, we had a number of staff members that went to some of the tours, spent some time, have been to a number of our meetings. They would probably, with an invitation, be willing to come in during the summer month to get this process kicked off. I think the designers are, you know, they've been through this and know how to do it. And I think, you know, as an example of what they did today and going through the school. So certainly it's our intent to involve as many people as we can. And you're right, you know, definitely the administration, content coordinates, and key staff. And maybe the content coordinators can identify key staff from their departments they'd like to have involved in the process.
Mr. Medeiros, the content coordinators, are they working at this point?
They have an extended contract with bid teachers. They're 15 more work days. Five are determined by the administration, mutually agreed upon in the course of the summer, in addition to the week when school ends, 1 week and 1 week before. So there's certainly some flexibility beyond, I think, the motivation and enthusiasm for this project specifically. So I think combined, I don't see that as an issue. Now, how large the group is going to be, I mean, I did see some real clear evidence today of the fact that they were, first of all, very pleased with the amount of staff cooperation. They were, I think, somewhat surprised in their experience at how much on target the numbers were that were provided. And that came really as a result of the building committee involving staff and departments already in this process. So I think today was an example of that. I think maybe next Wednesday at the building committee piece tied that through. So I don't see the summer as being short of maybe a personal vacation here or there as know, something that's going to delay the process. I think you're going to get the representation, and I would completely agree with you, Mr. Pierce, that's going to be representative of all the departments and programs, including, you know, directors at higher levels as well. And I'm confident we can accomplish that.
So again, that will be the focus of that next week's meeting to kind of get that process on board.
Anyone else on this issue?
I just had one follow-up piece to the approval. I supplied to Mr. Medeiros earlier today, I think, a sample letter. We have to notify the MSBA of the choice of AI3 as a designer, because they, in turn, have to then get involved in evaluation of fees and that sort of thing. They won't do that until they have that official notification. And it typically has come from the superintendent of the district, from the examples that we were given. So I supplied that as a sample to Mr. Medeiros, and then, based on the vote tonight, thank you. allow him to make that notification to MSBA.
We previously voted to designate Mr. Maderas as the chief executive officer so that he could make those kinds of notifications.
Okay.
Why don't we have a motion to specifically authorize Mr. Maderas to notify the MSBA that we have accepted the building committee's recommendation to enter into contract negotiations with AI3 Architects.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Souza and seconded by Ms. White. Any further discussion? In the absence of further discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Unanimous.
I know in the past, they've asked for the minutes of the meeting to show those votes. I don't know if you want to just send those along. I don't know when they need that. Is that going to jam up the whole process?
Well, the letter, I think, could probably go as early as tomorrow. And if they require the minutes, they can follow us or approve. They're not going to hold up for that. I mean, this is the firm, I think probably any of the firms who are involved in this homeschool process are pretty well established in MSBA. But they just like everything but the numbers. I'm not just following myself.
What I think I would do is get the letter out tomorrow. Buy copies for the committee for our next meeting on the 11th. At that time, these minutes will likely be approved, and we could then forward them as well. Although, I don't think there's any indication of that, but we certainly can do that in the next 2-week time frame.
Fine. Okay. And then the other piece is that we are working on cash flow for the next few months for the project. And once we have something on that, we'll get it in.
I had spoken with Mr. Fenstermaker and asked if he could talk with our
project manager
to come up with an outline of the amount of funding that we would need over the next few months, because obviously the project manager will begin billing us probably quite soon, and then as the architects will be probably devoting a lot of time over the next couple of months to this project, and we'll start getting their bills. But I was pleased to learn, speaking with Mr. Maderas, that we have already arranged for a sufficient financing so that we can probably deal with all of those expenditures. Hopefully we'll be able to submit for reimbursement pretty quickly after we've received the bill and paid it, so that we're rolling over the cash situation and we're getting reimbursed. We won't have to be expending the full amount of what it's costing for the design process. I guess we're on track as far as that's concerned.
So this doesn't require town vote to support funds for the building project?
No, we're the initial funds.
We did that all the way through construction.
Okay. Right, all right.
My one little side note, and I know I'm supposed to be brief, this is my last little piece, I'll plug it in. The approach that we took in getting the money approved through construction documents is not typically how that people get hung up on town votes getting that last piece. And actually, the MSBA is advising other districts that might want to consider using that approach. So we're helping them improve that. So,
as we have been.
Fine, thank you very much.
Mr. Pierce, just to wrap up the building.
Yes, I was going to suggest that there's one other item under building committee, and that's a report on the condition of the old building. And I was going to ask Mr. Maderas to provide us with a report on the condition of the old building.
Well, maybe it's timely because this an item, which I think was going to be kind of a standing item, condition of the old building, as we look at the next 2-3 years, we didn't have a story, but I do tonight. In relation to an incident that took place, we had some plaster in one of our art high school classrooms in the graphic design classroom. I say small classroom, it's about 20 by 22. When you walk down it's a 36 section of the building. There's a drop ceiling like in front of us here, but above that is the actual existing plaster. And in some classrooms, there's not even a drop ceiling. For some unknown reason, and we're exploring what the reason is, it doesn't appear there was any wet, any water damage or anything. Some of the plaster came down as a result, did some damage to some insulation in the pipe. We've shut down electrical work, and I guess confidently, I want to first of all reassure people that we've taken some action. The first thing we did is contact Banner Environmental. They've already been in. They handle any asbestos, and there's some asbestos around the pipe. That was the most significant piece, and I'll be honest, we were very concerned. College campus building ground supervisor, business manager, because that's where you can really bring some cost up with the asbestos abatement and those types of things. We were able to remove 58 feet of insulation off the pipes. 15 wet wraps were put around the main steam line. That was for $1,500. That's what that cost, that portion of it. We also had to get from DEP an emergency waiver, which Mr. Campos took care of, and hygienist took care of for a test later in the day, which cost about $200. And so we've got some additional electrical work to be done. We've taken care of the area, cleaned up the area with our maintenance staff and relation. And a real proactive approach, I want to share with the board, and certainly as the chief executive, because I took on with Carlos Campos the idea of getting O'Day Engineering in to kind of do some initial assessment and take a look. They've been our structural engineers. They handled the 55 section to determine, are there any other, first of all, what was potentially the cause behind that one classroom? And would there be any other issues in relation, because the entire 36 building, first floor, second floor, has that type of plaster, same time frame. Some areas have drop ceiling, some not. Students have been in the section and actually came down through the drop ceiling and hit the pipe. So I mean, as a result, it was in the summertime, we were able to handle it and take care of that. But I don't think we should simply, you know, just assume it was isolated to that area and that there may not be some other problems. That O'Day Engineering representative was here today at the high school to do, just to kind of get a sense of where the area was, do some initial inspections and get back to us. Now, bad news, I think it's a proactive, very appropriate response to take, and certainly, as you know, prior to the start of school, be aware. Obviously, this is a project and activity that we didn't anticipate, and an expense we didn't anticipate, and something we've got to monitor closely. But having said that, obviously looking at the safety of the school is our number one priority, and so we don't have any indication that there's any other issues at this point. But I think it's premature, and I'll, on August 11th, probably have a further update in relation, hopefully, to some structural work and take a look at what we can do. But it was isolated to that classroom, simply was observed, was taken care of, where we still have the electrical work shut off, there's some wiring that still has to take place, and then we'll have our drop ceiling and some things established. And I don't see that being a disruption for the start of school, which is obviously still, you know, 5 or 6 weeks away. But I want to bring that to your attention. I know there's some media attention given to that. Was that classroom? I try to point out, I apologize, I have a map here. So when you walk down the stairs in the art area, it's right where the, right next to that small room, right next to where the new elevator, now the elevator is 10 years old, that was there. We're trying to be sure that there are no other areas potentially that might be a problem in the 36 portion of the building. So,
is O'Day Engineering going to do kind of an evaluation of that building while they're there, is that what you're talking about?
So yes.
Evaluation. Yeah, is there a cost for that evaluation?
Well, that's what we're asking for, a proposal first, so before they go ahead and do 3 days of work and bill us at $15,000 or something, we have an idea of what that, typically their work has been, at least initially, they give us some indication, at a fee, obviously, and then determine if there needs to be some work. We don't have any belief, quite frankly, that there needs to be additional work, but really in a proactive approach, we didn't realize that some plasma was going to come off of that section, too. I'd be happy to answer any questions. That's most recent. I think in general, maintenance is going on for the school. We're cleaning it up. We're getting ready for the start of school. But that was one blip that we certainly didn't anticipate. But it shouldn't be shocking to anybody as we kind of move forward into school. We're talking about the ongoing concern over the next 2 to 3 years in relation to the condition of the building. So,
did you say that's happened before or hasn't happened before?
It has not happened before.
Where the plaster is falling. And how big of a space you're talking about? Is it small, big?
It was a large area. The classroom is 20 by 22. I would say 15 feet of that 20 by 22, the plaster came through.
And they don't know the cause of it?
They, our maintenance staff, structural engineers, right, are just looking at it to determine if it was just a matter of time coming. If you looked underneath, once we took the drop ceilings, you basically have strips of wood going across holding plaster that's been there since the 30s. And to see if it bowed simply enough that eventually the weight came down. And so we're trying to explore, and again, their guesses at this point, and that's why we're bringing in some structural engineers to take a look at, was some of the work that was done to create an elevator enough, even though it's 10 years out, to
provide a little less structure in that section, in that classroom, but it's right alongside that classroom. Again, it's, I'd rather leave that up to somebody with some expertise, and that's what we're calling in individuals to do. I think Mr. Pierce and I had a brief conversation on this matter when initially happened, and one thought would be, with some of the expertise on our building committee, that when we have, that maybe having several of those individuals also do the walkthrough with the building and grounds supervisor too. So I'm certainly not opposed to taking some in-house expertise in relation, and I think, you know, considering their commitment to the new building, an existing building in the coming years, I think it's a pretty, a good idea. So when I have Mr. Campos a better timeframe, I'll certainly have an update on the 11th. Wish I had better updates, but I think it's the reality where we're at.
Well, I think everyone's comfortable with at least getting a quote from O'Day Engineering as to what the cost of an inspection would be. We want to make sure that the area is safe for the beginning of the school year. I think we also need to kind of get a determination of what the bottom line is, and we can look at responsibility. So, are there any other thoughts on this issue?
In regards to the budget, I think going forward, when you develop a budget, I think you're going to have to develop in the budget maintenance for the building for the next 2 or 3 years, because I don't think that's going to be an isolated incident in regards to maintenance of keeping the building maintained. I'm not saying they're still in the fall, but I think it, unforeseen budget expenses going forward, I think you're going to should put some money in there in the budget going forward.
And we do. Actually, that is how.
We did increase the item for maintenance and repairs at the high school. But we also have the issue under the regional agreement as to certain certain items remaining in responsibility of the town of Somerset. So, but I think it's probably premature to look at that issue at this point.
I think the assessment will be a good tool, depending on how expensive it is, to kind of give us an, even an idea for budgeting going forward, what we have to expect.
This was the group, just for information for everyone, that did our work in the 50s portion of our building, that knew the structural issues there, that looked at the roof, so they are very familiar with the facility, and I'm very confident they can, in short time and hopefully at a reasonable rate, be able to determine that without having to do some, you know, some initial work that might be significant and costly. So when I receive that information, and my guess is we'll have that information by our next meeting on the 11th, I'll be able to provide that and move forward from there.
There's one other item under the old building and building committee that I want to raise with the committee, and that is the transfer of title to the land and buildings to the regional school district. And it's something that we need to move forward on promptly because we're beginning to engage an architect, and the SBA will be probably be asking soon about transfer. And the issue that occurs to me is whether we should engage an attorney to review the title to the property. And that's a standard procedure when you're conveying real estate. These circumstances are somewhat unusual because it's a municipality conveying to a regional school district and the consideration is nominal. But I think it would be wise to have a thorough review of title at this stage when any issues might be addressed and corrected, rather than wait to some point down the line when an issue might be raised and we're required to have a formal certification of title, and it hasn't occurred. And should we, the unlikely event that we come across an issue at that point, it'll be that much more difficult to resolve. So I'm not sure that our legal counsel would be in a position to do that kind of real estate work. I think it might be more appropriate to talk to a local attorney. I would think the cost would be far less than under the procurement statutes that would require us to advertise. I think we'd probably be able to engage an attorney of our choice to do that. I would imagine
The cost would probably be somewhere between $1,000 to do. So what I would suggest is that perhaps the committee tonight authorize me to at least inquire, perhaps come back to the next meeting with a proposal.
Is this something that our attorney that we currently have would not do?
I'm not absolutely certain about that, and I would inquire of him, but I think that his firm focuses primarily on representing school districts and involved in labor negotiations. This would be an issue that would be dealt with by an attorney that really specializes in real estate conveyancing.
Okay. So I'll move that motion to, I've got the warning, but so moved.
To at least obtain a proposal.
Authorized
to obtain a proposal.
So you're not moving for a vote?
Well, you know, I'd like to be authorized to get a proposal to bring back to the next meeting.
So
do we have a second?
I'll second.
All right, so the motion is made by Ms. White and seconded by Mr. Fisher. Any further discussion?
I think you're right on point. Look, we just need to clean up any kind of issues before we move on. So let's see what we have out there.
Okay. In the absence of further discussion, we'll take a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Unanimous. All right, so let's go back to old business. Staff report.
If I could just jump in for a second, I'm sorry, with the budget update, for our next meeting, if we could have, I know once the process gets underway with the building and the architects are visible and people starting to see things move, the questions are gonna come back. How is this gonna impact my taxes? So I think it's important that we revisit that maybe and just start to discuss that. I don't know if that's in the building committee's communication committee?
Well, yeah, I think it's definitely something we're gonna bring back once we know the final cost of that. I carry with me the documentation showing, based on what the town of Hamilton told us, at least in Somerset, what the cost, average cost per household would be.
Yep.
So absolutely, when we get to the point where we're going to be presenting an actual cost, and even as we develop the estimates, we'll bring it down to what a cost per household would be.
Because there are numbers that are floating right now. I just didn't want any momentum to be
right.
Growing in the wrong direction and then people getting nervous.
I think we need to be clear that while taxes might go up for a variety of reasons,
yep,
and different rates in the towns of both Somerset and Berkley, I know for a fact, based on the estimates we got from the town accountant last year, that an estimated cost of the project at $70 million was going to incur an average household annual increase of about $96 to $98.
Okay. That's what I had remembered. Yes. I had $100 in my head, yes, but there's something much higher going around. And I think we did a really good job, if I could say so, as far as breaking that down and presenting that to the public so that they would understand.
And that number hasn't changed,
no,
as far as I can see. It's really, I think, probably the closing of a power plant may have caused the taxes to go up. That would have happened whether or not the school was built. And other issues may have caused the taxes to go up. But if we isolate the cost of that building, we will certainly make sure that we're clear as to what that cost
so
will
still
be in both communities.
About $100.
At this moment,
in Somerset, I can't.
At this moment, there are zero taxes that are being increased in the town. It's not from this building project.
Right. And so any increases
so,
that have been
right. But I mean,
so people
sorry
need to know that.
Objective.
Yeah, people right need to know that, especially in Somerset. I don't know about Berkeley, but in Somerset, that zero taxes, that there will be an increase in people's tax bills. We know that. That's going to be happening in the next tax bill that's going out. and $0 of that tax increase is from this building.
Right, be attributed to.
And I think.
At this moment.
Virtually zero. The only expense that we're incurring right now is a very small amount of interest on the funds that we're required to borrow to kind of revolve and pay for the planning costs. But that amount, which is pretty small, because we're borrowing at an extremely low rate of interest, fortunately, probably around 1% or maybe slightly under, that's included in our budget.
And I know that the estimate that we got last year was based on a 5% interest rate, and it was for the total $70 million profit. So again, as we get closer and have more exact figures, we'll continue to bring that down in both communities so that we know what the impact is per household.
So are we ready to move on to the staffing report?
Mr. Peterson, thank you. I provided your place just an update in relation, and though I think it's been helpful for the Somerset group, at least K-8 that I'll be also dealing with, just gives you a sense of kind of where we're at in relation to positions that were filled or are currently in the process of being filled, and as it relates and where those positions are being filled. Sometimes you run into a situation where someone's asking about new positions or something's on the website and those types of things, and I think it's been helpful, at least on a monthly basis, if nothing else, to provide you the information as it relates to, and as you can see, it all goes back into the principal. I didn't indicate here, which I certainly can do for the future, whether it's a retirement or resignation, and I can go into some more details as it relates, but I've attached the names, and those are all of these positions that I've obviously been budgeted for and part of the process, and so there's nothing new here. We have some TBAs, because these positions are still being posted. I would like to add in the staffing report, I'm happy to answer any questions in relation to this as well, but I also would like to add an exciting piece that the new high school administration brought out for both Somerset and both the region, and that is to move forward talking about technology and to use School Spring as a vehicle by which we are now advertising. It would typically cost us about $1,500 per ad in a Sunday Journal. We're now paying shared cost, both region and Somerset, $1,500 for an entire year of ads. And I'll be honest with you, I was a little conservative in relation to meeting with the new principal, Dr. Mosley, as to how much different this would be. We kind of prided ourselves in Somerset on, at the K-8, and even at the high school level, on saying, listen, we attract quality candidates, so how much difference is this really going to make? Why spend the extra money when we can certainly obtain those elementary positions, seven teaching positions this year, 79 applicants for one teaching job, 85. Middle school and high school has been a little bit different, and this cost, by the way, for the region is $644, which is our advertisement cost, so it was budgeted, so it's not even costing the region more than we would typically pay out, and now we have it set for the year for all positions, including these current positions. If you go to our website, so now Somerset has that ability to do that, also the region, you can access that in a very convenient piece. It's been very common. I've had a school committee member on the Somerset board for several years now trying to push me to move this along. I can share with you, Dr. Mosley was very excited because he knew my apprehension as to how different this was going to be in relation to attracting quality candidates. So 2 days after the jobs were posted on the region, he quickly sent me off an email, and I asked if I could move this, and he said, well, just understand that those numbers are going to increase. And just to give you a little idea, the math teaching position 2 days into the posting, 45 applications. Social studies, history teaching position, 204 applications. ELA content coordinator, 25 applications. He was, and so am I, very pleased at the fact that we have prided ourselves on attracting quality people, and it looks like now we've even expanded that more through this process. And so it's exciting. Obviously, I don't know the detail behind what each of the applicants are and the qualifications and so forth, but I think one of the things that we've attempted to say over and over again for the Somerset Berkley Regional High School is that we need to expand the diversity as it relates to both our student population and staff, and this provides and opens up, I think, beyond the Sunday Providence Journal, you know, local, the Southeastern Mass type of scenario. Although, I in looking at the list, and I asked him to read off that because I was a little cautious as to, are people going to relocate from Idaho to come to Somerset in relation to the next 4 weeks? A lot of the positions were positions that were well within driving distance, so maybe they just weren't looking at some of the local papers, but they certainly were through this. So
I just want to share with the board, I didn't go into this much detail, but in relation to the fact that I think the current administration is making every effort to attract the highest quality staff. The positions that have currently been filled have some real high-quality people. I interview all the candidates prior to, you know, sending out appointment letters, and you see the list is identified in the future list, so. I'm happy to answer any questions. I usually open this up to the board if there's specific questions, but obviously everything's budgeted for and kind of moving forward. We tend to maybe have a teacher aide or something that may open up at, you know, in August, but I think we're well on target for the start of school.
The content coordinator for world language, is that someone who was in the department?
The content coordinator for
world language?
Yes, for world language was a teacher. That's correct.
And I believe I recognize the name of the English language arts teacher. That's someone that was at the high school as well?
Yes. That individual was a long-term substitute for the year, was hired for an entire year last year. That's correct.
How about the two science teachers?
The two science teachers are new to the district. One with experience coming from Rhode Island, the other less experienced, but obviously both licensed and certified.
And the special ed coordinator, tell us a little bit about her background.
Extensive background in two close areas. And so I very experienced. I mean, it's a critical position. I think that was a concern we had, that we were going to fill that with someone. We had someone with 34 years experience that not only knew the system, we all know the volatility of special education and the critical nature in relation to services. That position is being filled by someone with some Massachusetts experience. Not that that's necessary, but certainly it helps in the process as it relates to law and regulation. So. And each meeting, I'll continue to update them.
Any other questions? Members of the board? All right, thank you for that report, Mr. Medeiros. Next item, report of meeting of Health Insurance Trust. I'll provide just a very quick report, and then Julie can add to it if she so chooses. There was a meeting of the Board of the Insurance Trust held week ago today, I believe it was, and it was the first meeting. The representatives of the town were there. Patrick O'Neill from the Board of Selectmen was elected as the chairman of the board. Mr. Luttrell was elected as vice chair. The consultant was present. We talked about, just in very general terms, about the insurance plan. One of the issues that was discussed is the fact there's approximately, I believe, $7 million remaining in the trust fund. The revenue, the cost of the health insurance over the years is about $9 million. The revenue that is generated is about $9 million, I believe. But there has been, because of the claims that have been filed in the last year or two, the amount of the trust fund is down from its high point of about $9 million. So part of the discussion was whether insurance premiums should be raised at this point. No decision was made on that issue. It was deferred to the next meeting of the board, which will happen probably sometime in September or October. We were waiting. One of the considerations was to get the full report for the full fiscal year of the trust to see exactly how much the claims were above the amount of revenue that was generated in terms of premiums. And so the issue will be revisited. There was a general, I think it's fair to say, there was a general reluctance on the part of the people involved to increase premiums if it could possibly be avoided, because of the fact that increases and salaries have been very limited in the last few years, and the economic times are tough, and it's that much more difficult for people to absorb an increase in health insurance premiums. So I think that pretty much is a broad overview of what occurred. Mr. Medeiros, I also invited Mr. Medeiros and the treasurer and our interim business agent, business manager, to attend the meeting just because it was the initial meeting, and I want everybody to get a sense of what was going on and what it was about. I don't think our entourage was about equivalent to the town representatives, and of course we have one member of the board versus their five, but in any event, they weren't overwhelmed, and we did learn, I think it was worthwhile for everyone to be there. The treasurer, the town treasurer, one thing I didn't mention is that the town treasurer was elected treasurer of the insurance trust.
Was it the town treasurer, or was it?
Oh, right, I'm sorry.
I think it was, is he the town assistant?
The assistant treasurer, yes.
He was appointed.
That's right, Mr. Fitzpatrick.
The treasurer was.
Oh.
Yeah.
He was appointed assistant treasurer. There were two appointments.
Right.
The town treasurer.
The town treasurer is the treasurer of the insurance trust, and Mr. Fitzpatrick, the assistant treasurer, is going to serve as the assistant treasurer. They obviously work very close together. They're both very new to this whole insurance program, so they're working their way through and working out the kinks, but everything seems to be moving along smoothly, and everyone has health insurance in place, which obviously was our primary objective. So as this proceeds, we can keep an eye on what's developing and raise any questions that we think appropriate at the right time. So if there are no further questions about the insurance program, we'll move on to the next item, which is a discussion of the process to establish goals for the superintendent. As we all know, the superintendent's contract provides for an incentive based upon performance goals, which we should try to establish as early in the year as possible so that he has an adequate opportunity to focus on the goals and achieve them. So I don't think that it's an appropriate topic of discussion for the seven of us to sit here and try to work out a set of goals. I think it would be, just my own view is that an issue that a subcommittee could undertake, working with the superintendent, and then come back and report to us, to the entire committee, on the goals that they've discussed and perhaps come to agreement on, or whatever the resolution of the process. From my perspective, I think it's important to try to come up with some objective, measurable goals rather than kind of grand, but rather amorphous and very difficult to measure type of goals, but that will be up to the subcommittee, but we certainly welcome any other thoughts, a discussion on this topic.
I think that the subcommittee would work together with Mr. Medeiros.
Absolutely.
Should the two committees work together, this committee and the Somerset School Committee work together, so that in case it's going to be some common goals, and then maybe there'll be some goals that apply to the two districts?
I think we can cooperate as long as we can move along quickly.
Depending on who the subcommittee is, that could even be done more efficiently as well. I support the piece. I in my discussion with Mr. Pierce earlier, I had said it, I intentionally did not submit typically with the Somerset Board. I at least submitted some draft and literally stamped them as draft goals, so it was not assumed. I chose not to do that. This is the first time with the board, because I didn't want it to be assumed that I was telling the board what my goals should be and that they need to be mutual. So I mean, I think once that subcommittee meets, if you want me to send something to those individuals and then we can sit and meet, I think that makes a lot of sense, and I think we can do that in a pretty quick, efficient fashion.
Yeah, I'd like to have it move along as quickly as possible. It might be a good idea to have one of the Somerset School Committee representatives from our board and another member, and if the Somerset Board would allow for sort of that person from our board who's on the Somerset Committee to be also one of their representatives, and maybe come up with a three-person committee so that you have one member from each of the committees, and then a third member, kind of a member of both committees. So we can do that. Why don't folks let me know who's interested in serving, and we can designate our representatives. Perhaps the Somerset School Committee members can speak among themselves and decide who.
Well, we need Tuesday night, so it'll be pretty timely.
Would it be helpful to come up with how many subcommittees we're going to have, and then we can, instead of each time you come here, we go up in a subcommittee, would it be more helpful to identify how many subcommittees we have, and then people can decide what subcommittees they want to be on?
Yes, I think that's an excellent idea, and I think what we should do for our next meeting is have a list of the subcommittees that we had for the interim school committee. But I'd like to see this particular issue move along as quickly as possible. So.
I would be interested, I don't know if anybody else is, represent the regional committee, but if someone else was interested.
Jamie's not into these, I think, so you know. There's no one else here, so I'm willing to do that. So then we can...
Just need on Tuesday night the Somerset member.
So
Wednesday morning.
So we have two volunteers from our committee, if that's acceptable. All right. NEAS update. This, I believe that Liz, you asked at one point that this matter be put on the agenda to review the first responsive and filed to the accreditation committee. I think it's important for us to understand what this committee's role is with respect to the accreditation report and the process that's designed to respond to it, and then and also to be kept current on what the process is as it moves along. My impression from the report was one of the major issues that was raised in the accreditation report focused on the physical condition of the building. And that's certainly being addressed as effectively as promptly as it can be. But there were other issues that were also raised that I think are important. So I don't know if anyone else has any other thoughts. Madeiros.
I was going to say, it would be helpful to understand, being new to the process, what our role is in the NEAS report. Is it just becoming informed from time to time as to what the progress is of that committee? Are they an active committee? Do we have any responsibilities?
Obviously the board is, it's a limited piece in relation to the school board piece. I chair Mr. Pierce, I think you had a June report from the previous administration, progress report as it relates to the initial report. My recommendation would be in the fall, allowing Dr. Mosley and his administrative team a little bit of time to kind of get up and running this fall, that they report out in that process. And I'm talking September, early October, we can determine what meeting it is, not only give a progress report as it relates to some of those specifics, rubrics, and things that were also cited beyond the facility, but also talk about what the role of the board is as it relates to that. I think it's most appropriate. I think that's what we have done in the past. There is a group already in place at the high school in relation. I just, in fairness, being July and the new principal being on board, I would simply ask that maybe a few meetings be established. And I think that's not too far out where you're losing grasp as to making sure there's updates, but that would be my recommendation, that one of the, you know, maybe the
the second September meeting or the October meeting, first October meeting, be the time that the committee, be provided an update from the new administration in relation to where we're at, where they're at in relation to the ask, as long as the board's comfortable with that.
How about if we suggest that you speak with Dr. Mosley between now and our next meeting and get a sense from him? We realize that he's only been on the job for about three weeks, and I'm sure he has all kinds of things, pressing matters. So get a sense from him of when he thinks he'd be in a position to give us a meaningful report, but also convey to him that we're anxious to hear sooner rather than later.
Okay.
And then at the next meeting, we can perhaps
agree
upon a time frame when we might expect to hear from him.
Absolutely.
Technology assessment and collaboration.
Put that on my.
I had mentioned that at our last meeting, but I know that Mrs. Gagliotti, I think you have some thoughts about it as well.
Yeah, I wanted to look at the possibility of evaluating what we currently offer to our students at the high school level, with the concern that we're serving a group of students over the next 3 years, and we should try to provide as much as possible to them during that time frame, within reason. And I know that there's a very active technology task force at the K-8 group, and they've already made strides in that area. And trying to link with what they're doing, but at the same time, recognize that this is a different situation. We're not going to spend a tremendous amount of money in infrastructure. But I think that there might be a possibility to look at what is there, what can we reasonably put in or provide to those students that then might even be able to be carried into the new building in the future. So one of the thoughts I had was to have perhaps an assessment done, just as you're having O'Day come through and do a structural assessment, have an outside group come in and look at what the capabilities of the existing building and what's there and what we might be able to do.
Yeah, I agree. Even with the best case scenario, we have 3 full academic years ahead of us in the existing building, and we can't say to the students who are going to be there for the next three years, you have to wait till the new building before we do anything in terms of even just rotating the technology that is existing there. So I think it's important that we, particularly in view of the work that's being done at the K-8 level, that we work collaboratively and try to get a good handle on what, if any, needs there are that we can address on an interim basis until we have the new facility in place.
If I could go kind of one further step on this, is that in 3 years there will be that new building with new technology, and having teachers kind of go into that kind of green and not really see all that technology. I don't know if it's something for us to start considering is to be bringing somebody on board to really just kind of focus on technology in the high school and what is going to be coming up later on. And that's something I think we could turn to Dr. Smith, I'm staring at right now, and see how we can kind of move forward. And do we need a person in place for that, or do we have different kinds of trainings, you know, towards that?
I'm a little confused about what you mean by bringing an outside personal group in, because I know that we have a technology department, we have tech people in place who could probably generate that report of what's there. I think Dr. Smith could probably speak to the professional development piece, because I know that he oversees that for the entire district. So he does an outstanding job of tying in and even tying within the 8 to 9 to 10, so that there's that nice flow. I just don't understand what you mean by, do you mean bring in like an outside company in?
Well, there are outside companies I looked at that do come in and do that. And they, some of them are already vendor, one is already a vendor, but there's other companies that come in. And typically for districts that have a small staff, they'll do that. And it's not imposing their view, they actually do focus groups with the staff and kind of gather the information about what they have, what they need, what they would use, bring information about what the new trends are out there. My thought is if we can do that in-house, that's fine, but I think that that's gonna be helpful if we could have that done, the exercise done, not just for the next 3 years, but that also gives us an idea of what we're gonna be needing to input to this new building going forward. So I think that exercise is worthwhile doing, A, for the students that are gonna be there for the next 3 years, to see what is reasonable. Some of these companies that do that, I think Celt is one of them, and I found 4 others, typically they'll, it depends, you work out a contract, we may not need it, but I think it's something worth looking at. And then they offer rebates or discounts on whatever is purchased. Some of them actually have guidance on looking for grants in those areas, which is something that, you know, we've talked about needing to do more. So it's just, from my understanding, that group is working very hard already in K-8, and there's a lot of work to be done, that if the staff can continue to do that in high school, that's fine, but if it's more of a task that can be managed at this time, then maybe bringing someone else with fresh eyes to look at it might make sense, depending on the cost.
I like the idea. I just would hesitate until we have a grasp on the feedback from O'Day, what we're looking at structurally, because that's going to be our priority concern, making sure that building is stable and ready to go, and kind of have an idea of what we're looking at a year from now, if they can even predict that. And I think our first step should be, if we are going to move forward with this, is to utilize the staff we have.
Can I just say,
I think Mr. Mid- I'm sorry, go ahead.
I'm not familiar with the Somerset school system, so I assume in Somerset there's already technology in place, there's already a technology program in place, so I don't know if you mean improving on that technology program or revamping the whole thing. I guess my concern is we're talking 3 years, and I assume you already have technology in the high school, so I'm not sure where we're going with this in regards to talk about improving a system that's going to be around for only 3 years. I
would not advise putting money into a building that's going to be knocked down, absolutely not, but looking to see what can be done with what we have, what types of grants we can go out for to get equipment that might be used now and then carried into the new building.
So you're saying it's not
I'm not looking
working now, but you want to improve the system, I guess, is that where we're going with?
I don't think we're going to build a building that will have the same type of technology that we have now. That's certainly not our goal. We want something better.
Most computers don't have much more than 3 to 5 years of useful life anyway. But Mr. Medeiros, I think you have some thoughts.
Yeah, the clock was ticking. I was trying to patiently wait, which isn't necessarily my forte. My suggestion would be, knowing the board, and we have new members here, that the director of technology in his department, and maybe consistent with the director of curriculum, provide for the board an assessment of what exists. I mean, let's, in fairness, let's see what we have, and let the professionals lay out kind of what exists in the current building. I don't disagree at all. We can't simply use the line for the next 3 years. Wait till you get the state-of-the-art new building for those 3 grades that are currently in place. But I think it is very much not accurate to say that. In fact, there aren't some high quality technology that's taking place. There's some infrastructure issues, and I guess my first request would be, you have a shared position, director of technology, both for Somerset and the region, director of technology in a small department, and you start with that piece, which is, this is what's in place, and then potentially it may involve bringing in other players if in fact we're trying to amp this up a little bit in relation. That would be my piece. And I know I've said this a couple of times in relation to reports, but I think that in a very timely fashion, early fall, I can get the director of technology here to give you an update, talk about the computer labs, talk about what the classroom access is, talk about the grade book portal that's in existence, talk about teacher websites, I've had some lengthy discussion with the current principal, the new principal, who's very, very tech savvy in relation to wanting to see some upgrades in the high school website in relation to that. So, I think I'd have the principal
come into that, even though there's a new piece, you know, new principal to talk about what he envisions over the next couple of years. That would be my, I think, the first, the starting portion for this, and then ultimately the board may have some direction in relation to some other activities. That would be my recommendation at this time.
Dr. Smith?
I was just going to make a comment and really expand upon your comments, which I think are very timely. At the end of the year, I had a meeting with the content coordinators, and I think one of their concerns was to make sure that we're maximizing the technology in the building right now and the resources we have to make sure we're using those effectively and realign and readjust as needed. For example, two of the content coordinators in math and science were taking a look at how we're using smart boards and how we can utilize the technology lab up on the second floor and maybe make some minor adjustments within the lab so that we can continue to maximize technology, because the issue that surfaced is we don't want to put technology on hold for the next 3 years. But I think the other important piece is that if you really do a member check at the high school and you take a look at what's going on in terms of technology engineering within the current infrastructure and the current building, it's quite impressive. And what people are doing within the content areas and also in the specialist areas as well. So I think the challenge is, how do we tap into what we currently have, those resources, and at the same time, I think you'll be able to use that as a way to really inform the next steps as you go into a new building. But I think if we just do an internal assessment, I think that we can get a good sense of where we are, you know, to guide us for the next 3 years. But I think clearly we have some resources in that building right now that we can certainly continue to expand upon.
One thing I'd like to see in that assessment is the percentages of teachers utilizing the technology to its fullest.
Well, it was,
to see if there is some sort of, you know, professional development coming in or whatever that's going to be needed, or do we think of maybe at some point putting somebody in that just does that on a continuum?
Well, for example, like one of the issues that surfaced was maybe relocating one of the smart boards that's stationary, maybe in the library, attaching it to the tech lab, mm-hmm. and then restructuring that a bit so that you'd be able to use some of the online applications in the current lab that you have, and then continue to do that for the next 3 years. So we definitely don't want to put it on hold, and I think we definitely have a lot at the current high school right now that we can continue to build upon with that current infrastructure, and certainly with the staff in place to really do an initial assessment and member check of what we have. So I think
using the staff that's in place makes sense, especially because we want their input going forward. We don't want to put technology in, we don't want to hold them back, but we also don't want to put technology in there that they don't find useful. So I think that.
Right, so I think it's a matter of how do we navigate
right.
the current limitations, but at the same time, taking a look at the staff that we have. And I think that there, many people have been immersed in the technology piece. I certainly have. And, you know, how we can then take what we have and how do we cut and shape it as we move into a new building. So I think we've got a lot of the expertise in place, and I think it's just a matter of kind of consolidating what we currently have and putting it down on paper, perhaps. But it's quite impressive, though. I mean, I have to say, when I see the work that they're doing in technology engineering, we had some teachers working at the end of June, continuing the curriculum development piece. And I think when you go into the tech labs, and also you see the applications in the other areas, I think it's quite promising. So that's where we are.
Okay, so what I would suggest is another assignment for the superintendent.
I'm getting that trend, I see that coming.
To consult with the director of technology and the director of curriculum and give us a time frame at our next meeting, when a realistic time frame
sure.
for when we can have a report that identifies what we have and obviously positives, but also
yeah.
what concerns there might be in terms of, I mean, there are there are things that we could be doing over the next 3 years in terms of professional development. It may, obviously, I'm sure that you have some members of the high school faculty that are working extremely effectively with technology. You have others, maybe like myself, that are less well-versed and enthused, and you know, we could perhaps be thinking in terms of professional development over the next 3 year period.
Right.
Those kinds of issues that, you know, would be, I think, positive in terms of things that we could be working on in the interim.
But we can certainly support the professional development piece and structuring that, not only for the current building, but also as we look ahead to the building.
I'll have an update on the 11th.
Great. All right, so lunch program, that was placed on the agenda at the request of Mrs. Naraki, and she's not here. I believe her only concern was to monitor the financials, well, various aspects of the lunch program. I guess we're concerned about quality and customer satisfaction, but also we want to make sure that the program is financially self-sufficient. So I think perhaps again we could ask the superintendent to speak with the director, the food service director, about what kind of reporting she can provide to us on a periodic basis. I mean, I'm not talking about bi-weekly or anything like that, but we want to have a handle. It was an issue at budget time that the program should be self-sufficient, and I know we've taken some steps in the interim, but perhaps we can get periodic reports to ensure that everything's progressing.
Absolutely. I can talk to Mrs. Auburn and make sure there's a monthly report. Maybe it's a subset of the budget piece, but in addition, I know we're not just talking finances, but talk a little bit about the program, and I certainly, once we start up in the school year, we'll be able to provide that through Mrs. Auburn.
So the next item on the agenda is strategic planning / retreat.
I didn't put the retreat down.
No, I put the retreat down because I thought if you're going to really undertake serious strategic planning, it requires something more than an item on the agenda of a meeting like this in the evening. It probably requires setting aside a significant amount of time, and good strategic planning requires a certain amount of advanced preparation, so it's probably something we should be thinking of if we're really committed to coming up with a five-year strategic plan, that we should be thinking in terms of how we would approach that and what the time frame might be.
And how was yours not a five-year? The strategic plan that you just completed.
The subcommittee?
Yeah.
I assume we were continuing.
Yes.
Okay. So that is a first. My thought was, as I read it, was like, this is a first attempt at the strategic plan, right? But that it's going to continue?
I thought we were continuing. The last meeting was held at 2:30, so I couldn't be there, but the way the emails were coming through and the communication from some of the people that we were continuing, you know, once school started up again. Mr. Ramirez, were you planning on continuing yet?
Yeah, I mean, I think the issue, and Dr. Hammond spearheaded that with the transition, and I know Mrs. Correa and I think Mr. Patrick at the time was also a representative for the school committee. I recognize he's not, he's on the transition group. And I think the thought process would be new principal, new superintendent coming on board, that we could certainly bring that, take that document moving forward. I don't want to lessen the significance though, because I know a lot of players, a lot of individuals in the school took part of that process, and so I didn't need to take that existing document and work off of that. I have not established any scheduled ongoing meetings in relation to that. I don't think we need a new document though. I would say that we need to work off of that document. I think, you know, that group, and you can speak to it, was well represented by all the stakeholders in relation to community, school committee, staff, administration,
it was a great group, very enthusiastic. I actually think if we go off on another track, they're going to be not only disappointed, but I think they're going to feel like all their work was taken away from them.
All right, so why don't we take a little time for all of us to familiarize ourselves with the strategic plan that resulted from that committee, from the subcommittee's work. We will, when we address the subcommittees, we can probably continue the strategic planning subcommittee, and this isn't a matter that is urgent in any sense. It's something that we want to continually evolve, so I think we can approach it that way. All right, so the anything further on that? So the next item is the business manager subcommittee update. Who would like to report on behalf of the
there really isn't an update. We haven't met since the last update we had given this committee. It was difficult to schedule interviews because everybody was on vacation. So we do have, thank you to Michelle, we do have some interviews scheduled. We will be interviewing three candidates. And hopefully we'll have something to report next week.
Next Friday night, August 5th.
In the evening?
In the evening.
Really?
That's the only day we can
host. They didn't ask me for a time frame. I'm going to have to try to convince my wife we have three Friday sessions going on.
My wife did ask
Friday
you.
Evening
oh, Friday meeting?
So, but yes, it was scheduled, and they are all three candidates responded.
Mm-hmm. All right. Any other discussion on that topic? What I would suggest is once the interviews have occurred and there's a recommendation from the committee, that we should circulate at least some information about each candidate to the committee in advance of the meeting, so that when we're making the final decision, we have had an opportunity to review some information.
How are we proceeding with that?
Yeah.
Once we do have a recommendation for, I'm assuming, a finalist, is that going to be a joint meeting with both committees, or?
I assume it will have to be. And again, I would hope that it would be kind of ranking the three candidates that you have, but that's just my preference. But yes, I guess it is a joint decision, so.
Well, is it the hope that we're bringing one candidate forward, but information on the three, or is a subcommittee done its job and then we're going to be bringing the three in?
With the ranking.
Well, I guess we would have to discuss that with perhaps the two chairpersons should talk about process and then bring it back to the.
I don't have it in front of you, Mr. Pierce, but I think there are specific steps.
Well, that's what you did.
There is specific steps, but the one thing that is kind of vague is do we bring in just what the subcommittee wants to recommend
as a finalist,
or bring in all three with a ranking? That we did not discuss in the procedure. Because that was part of the whole procedure of setting it up, and that just, so that's.
I would recommend that the subcommittee interview the three and then bring them back for both committees to interview them again. I just think it would be.
Yeah.
I've only been involved with superintendent search, but usually when we did that, you narrowed the field down, and then we did submit three to the boards, and then you had all the people come make a presentation, and then the committee voted from there. So when I was on the superintendent's committee, the committee was involved in just going through all the interviews, narrowing down people, who we're going to interview, made the interviews, then we submitted recommendations for the school committee to have them come in, make their presentations, and the school committee vote. As opposed to, because if you only put in one, and if you don't like that one person, then you stop, you have to vote. I mean, my recommendation would have submit three names, and then, but if you only have three, did you?
We narrowed it down. We narrowed it down to three, to bring in for the initial one. So, I mean, my take would be, I mean, before kind of jumping ahead, is let us do the interviews, and if we feel comfortable with bringing two of them in, then we bring in two, and we can kind of give you a ranking, or...
I don't know if we should be doing a ranking, if we're going to be bringing more than one candidate forward, only because I think if we're going to be bringing two, then it has to be the decision of both boards together. They have to be that decision, right? I would think. Because we need to get this president in place.
Yeah, it's nice to narrow down to two, but then don't rank them, have them come in, they can make their presentations, then when we decide, you get the members can say, well, that was my top choice. You know what I mean? That was my top choice. But maybe it seems probably the best way to do it.
You don't have that procedure, because I know that you know, you need to sort
out. I don't have it with me, but I mean, off the top of my head, it basically goes from to the subcommittee, we narrow it down, we bring in the initial into a joint session. So it would be a joint session. But it's very vague in what do we bring in? Do we bring in, I mean, can't say top three because we're in the
right,
just three.
I mean, for purposes of tonight, I apologize, I don't have it in front of me either. I think this specific language in relation to the process and yet, I mean, we know we have a meeting scheduled, three interviews scheduled for Friday. We have an upcoming session, so I think, one, we should review the existing document to see if there's already language specific to what the process is, and then we can also, as a subcommittee, talk about that and be sure, obviously, we follow it and report back to each board, rather than have us kind of guess at this stage what that is.
Yeah, I think we ought to finalize the process at our next meeting, and perhaps some discussion can occur at the Somerset meeting next week as well. And that would be in advance of the interviews, I guess.
Right? Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so hopefully we can work collaboratively and come up with a process
that's mutually acceptable. When we follow the procedure, I mean, to the point, and we'll definitely make sure that we follow everything.
But I think that we need to know up front before we even walk into the interview with those candidates, we need to know what to tell them. So the next step would be or what they could expect to happen after they walk out of that room.
I thought it was outlined in that.
It does leave the door open as vague as far as how many we're bringing forward. The final process is for both boards to be a joint meeting and make that final determination. But I don't think it speaks to the number of candidates brought forward.
We don't have a joint meeting set yet.
No, we don't.
So we should have.
I can't make the 11th. I know that date was changed from our last meeting. I can't make the 11th. So.
Actually, Liz and I were talking the other day. The 11th has the something has gone.
But I mean. What's the next meeting of the Somerset School Committee after next week's meeting?
25th. I think there should be something done probably the week prior to move the process along.
It was more, I mean, initially, they proposed the meeting, I believe the original meeting on the 18th, and I'm not sure if that was a conflict. It was moved up to the 11th.
What? I know.
Yeah.
I'm not sure why. It was the 18th.
I'm not here, but I'm the only one that's not here.
I'm not on the subcommittee.
I will not be.
You will not be here on the 18th?
But I can do 15th, 16th, 17th.
Are you away the entire week?
Yes. I leave the 13th and back the 20th.
I mean, unless we set something up even the week of the 8th. Oh, that's right.
Well, I mean, the other, I just, again, this is discussion purposes. You could have a, you could, we have a scheduled Somerset meeting on the 25th. You could potentially look at a joint meeting before, after, on that date. You know, it's a little few weeks out, but I'm here in vacation time, there's an issue, so we know we have an established meeting of the Somerset Board on the 25th. We could look at that, at least for discussion purposes.
Well, we do have an interim person in place, so. Is everyone available on the 25th?
I just think that's a lot to wait. If you're a candidate, that's a lot for weeks to expect someone.
We are in current position.
I'm available anytime in the month of August, but I think it's an important decision and we ought to try to come up with a date.
Well, it sounds like the 11th is going to be a question for the regional board right now, as our regular meeting.
Is the 8th on?
I mean, if it was the 11th, it was...
And the 8th, you said, Anne, was not good for you. That whole week?
Wait, when do you...
I'm available the 11th, but not before that.
And the 12th? Friday night?
Is that Christmas?
Yes.
That's, yes, at the graduation, yes.
So are we, you're supposed to attend?
The following week?
I think she's away, right? Your week, the what?
Yes.
Not available.
I'm trying to come back. If everybody else, I mean, is there a date during the week of the 14th that works for everybody else?
Well, the 16th is, I have it down, maybe it's not, though. I have it down as a building committee.
We have the 3rd. I don't think...
The 3rd, we haven't set any other dates.
We haven't set any other dates. We have tentative, but we didn't go any further because of, with...
Project manager.
Yeah, project manager, the designer and everything.
Well, what was the 18th? Was everyone, were most people available the 18th?
I think, I am not available.
Oh, okay, sorry.
She's not, and I think Jen might not be.
Okay.
And of course, we're setting a meeting and we're not talking with the Somerset School Committee about their...
Well, I know, but at least if we come up with a date or a couple of dates, we can bring it forward Tuesday and have something to work with. But yeah, I know what you're saying. We couldn't have three people say they can't be there.
So right now, the only date we have...
I think that's a strong consideration.
It's a tough time. This is a tough time of year.
Yeah, the 25th right now is the only, the 25th of August is the only possibility, although it's far away from the 5th.
Right.
Well, I think we should just...
Both committees could authorize me the ability to go ahead with the business manager and I could proceed and have our... I'm trying to say that with a straight face, but I can't even look at my chair and do that.
I think we should just explain to the three candidates that we tried very hard to find a date before the 25th and we were unable to do it, so... and I'm sure they'll appreciate all of them. I believe all of them having some school experience would understand the problem of scheduling a joint school committee meeting in the month of August. So
we're shooting for the 25th, is that?
Yes, for a joint meeting.
Are we rescheduling the 11th? We're going to wait till the end to discuss that. And, okay.
What do you think the time frame will be, just so that decision if we should have some school committee meet that next week? Because that was one of our, that was our meeting date. Mm-hmm. So do you have any feel of the time?
You know, see, it all depends.
Yeah,
I mean, it all depends if we're bringing in 3, 2, 1.
Right.
I mean, so.
We really won't know until after the 5th.
that's why I think, yeah, the 25th, is, I mean, having it on a scheduled date already for a meeting.
I think we need to come to an agreement as far as number of going forward. We need to say we're going to be choosing the top two, we will be in contact with you.
If we did that with the, I know it's a different search, but when we did it with the project manager for the building committee, I think that they had scaled them and they ended up with the top two. And we had to meet first with the top one. If that didn't go well, then we brought in the second one. And I know that's a totally different process, but I think it's
the whole building.
So that the subcommittee narrowed the field and had ranked them and came up with the top two. The top one was brought in that first night, which I'm not saying it has to be that way. But that was because of MSBA guidelines. That's why we had to negotiate with the top ranked project manager. But I think in this case, maybe you have them both come, because you don't want to delay it even more, have both of them come in, the top two come in that day.
And kind of like what you did with the architect, have them both come in, ask some questions for both of them, and then after they leave, you can discuss and pick one.
So why don't we leave it that we will interview at least the top two candidates, because the Somerset School Committee has to have some input. Mm-hmm. And if they say we want to see all three, then it'll be problematic. So why don't we take the position that we would agree to interview the top two, and if that's agreeable to Somerset, fine. If they insist that all three candidates are interviewed, then we'll do that.
And when is that?
I think we should postpone the interviews on Friday that we have scheduled.
Well, the Somerset School Committee will be meeting before the
right.
before those.
But if they're insisting on bringing three forward, then I think we should postpone those interviews that we have scheduled with them right now.
It might be hard to reschedule.
Well, you mean
no
cancel
kidding,
them and just have them interviewed by
yes.
the whole committee
yeah.
rather than the subcommittee?
Yep.
Well,
we've pretty much exhausted, I guess, from where we're coming from. If you can remember, the process didn't start out so well. We've pretty much exhausted the questions that you can ask a business manager. And for some of these candidates, this is not the first, nor second time that they've heard these questions posed in a variety of ways. So I think we're kind of painted ourselves into a corner where if we are going to be bringing three and we're at the position where we have three that we're interviewing, then we need to do that collaboratively as one, as a joint meeting. Because
which would be against, though, the votes of both your boards,
right.
which voted on a process by which you were going to follow.
But
I'm okay with it. I mean, you're the board, you can do that.
Is it a process to bring, or is
Liz,
it
I don't disagree with you, but it is, I mean, that was a pretty contentious discussion about we didn't follow the process and now we're going to start a new process. And
well, that's why I'm concerned to read the process to make
is
sure.
Is everyone on this committee comfortable with just bringing forward two?
That would be
and
my
And I'm
more
pointed to you, maybe, because I'm trying, you know
Oh yeah, I would say, I mean, it might even be one.
Well, there's two.
I mean, I don't, we haven't interviewed the three of them, and I mean, it could be maybe none. I mean, there's
yeah,
a lot
two
of assumption.
Two of the candidates have not been interviewed.
Yeah, so there's a lot of assumption here because, you know, we haven't brought, like Mr. Madeira said, two of them have not even been interviewed. So we're going to be bringing them in. Could be two. It could. You could say, you know what, we have three very strong candidates.
Well, that's a possibility,
and
too. And then
we
you
bring,
might change your mind.
But I understand what Liz is saying. I mean, once that initial interview, you've really exhausted all questions for a business manager, because what else would you ask them? I think the only process would be you would have at the entire committees, the two committees would have to then really hear out those answers once again, as a subcommittee would just sit there and say, we know who we want, we've heard the answers.
So the thought was, and I'm sorry I don't have that process in front of me, but the
mm-hmm.
thought, the process doesn't dictate that it is the subcommittee that brings their chosen candidate for a vote by the joint committee? Because then,
Michelle.
All the work was done to come up with this procedure, you don't want to go against.
Because ironically, she said that 15 minutes ago, and I said, no, that wouldn't necessarily. I mean, you are suggesting, I'm not opposed to the process, I mean, but what you're really doing is moving three finalists forward to the final stage, and that's pretty atypical for a position to this extent. They'll have had no interviews until they get to both boards. So you could have two boards with someone who you don't feel is short of a.
I would feel comfortable.
That's a fast track. I want that approach in future jobs, which is you don't have to have any screened. I'm not suggesting that.
Well, I think there was. I don't know. I wouldn't go to that extent where they're pulled off the street and completely green, because that's not true. We did extensive discussions and paper screenings, and I mean, we felt confident enough to be bringing them in to interview them. My concern is that how many times are you going to give the same test to the same kid? Like, of course they're going to score 100 after a while, third time around, poor analogy. So,
well,
I'm just wondering.
You think the point committees and ask the same question too? I mean, I'm sure we'll come up with different questions.
Well, I'm going to kick it out. That would be my recommendation. I mean? Kick it out and say, come up with a question that you would like to ask. And I think our next discussion in the future would be, is it going to be just the chairs of each committee that are asking questions? And everybody has a score sheet. How do you want to move forward with that joint committee process?
Where are you guys at now? How many applicants did you have?
Again, round two. And we have...
Nine.
Yep.
So you whittled it down to one interview?
No, I'm sorry, 10. We had 10.
And you interviewed only three out of those 10?
I do have it. It had a different cover sheet. I'm so sorry.
Tell Michelle.
It says...
Right
here. The chair and the vice chair for both committees need to discuss with you. No, that's not it.
No. The school committees need to
join
help, share positions outside. Search committee can conduct the search without consultant. So that's what we did.
But it does say
recommended to the school committee by the search committee. It doesn't say number or anything like
but
that.
But it does say the two school committees meet jointly to interview the final candidates.
Yes.
The two school committees vote to appoint the shared position, and the separate votes are taken, and both committees agree on the person to hire by majority vote of each committee. So that's interesting. If I read it, but I wasn't part of this, that mean that the two committees are together. The interview process is conducted with all members present in the room, but then each of those committees go on in a separate way and vote separately.
Well,
by majority.
I don't think we have to go on a separate way.
But
I think it's just a matter of both committees have to vote.
In a separate vote?
Yes, separate.
Okay.
Because we have overlapping people.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean,
wasn't clear that they had, that the joint committees had a responsibility to interview, but they in fact knew according to the process.
So the question is, coming back to the question, do you want one or two?
I don't think we make that decision. I think the subcommittee that's doing the initial interview has to make that decision of who should be brought forward. That's how I read it.
I thought you said candidates.
Candidates.
Would be more than one. So I say you bring the two you feel most comfortable can run it, and bring before both committees and have them answer any questions they want, and the two committees vote and the final person.
I would think that out in the business world, that would probably be common. You meet with a group, and then you've got a board that you meet with in your final round. So two rounds of interviews, I would think, are pretty customary out there. Is that?
Yes.
No? Yeah.
I mean, for a business manager position, it's very common that several candidates have public meetings with the board.
That's pretty wild.
And those boards in this instance.
Yeah.
So I think we should go back to what I suggested, because if the subcommittee only brings one candidate forward, it's really a matter of the subcommittee making the decision. I would suggest, as I did earlier, that we give the subcommittee discretion to bring at least two candidates before us for the final round, and the subcommittee can decide if it's going to be two or three. and assuming that's acceptable to the Somerset Committee, that's the way we'll proceed on the 25th.
And then allow the subcommittee with the chairs to organize how that meeting will run. Sorry, scheduling, who's coming?
Right, is that the consensus? Do we need a motion?
I'll take the motion.
All right, so that's the way we'll proceed. Hopefully the Somerset Committee will see it the same way. All right, so now under new business, policy manual and crisis manual, perhaps we can take those items up together.
Yeah, I mean, there's one specific request under policy, but I just simply want to note at your place the adopted, approved regional policy manual and also the crisis response manual is provided. Those are your copies as board members. Typically, you've had the policy manual. Typically, the school board in Somerset has not received the crisis manual. It's more related to an employee, but from an informational perspective, first time, we want you to have those copies. And really need to thank my administrative staff for putting this together. Michelle and Luann put this together based on the discussion, I think, at our last meeting in relation to that. So it doesn't make for great summertime reading, I'll be honest with you. We had a subcommittee that put together the policy and looked at the policy manual from this board and also the crisis, and I was a member of that as well. And one of our current board was a member of that. But I think it reflects certainly some continuity and consistency among the two boards. And what I would recommend is as we kind of move forward into the year, I think we're going to have enough agenda items, but one of the practices is for a review of policies and or as MASC comes out with some adaptations or pieces, those should be presented. It kind of could be an ongoing agenda item for the board to review.
Subcommittee that we had in place. All right, so we have under the policy manual, Mr. Souza asked that we put on the agenda the policy for field trips.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, it's a typical procedure that from time to time the Somerset Committee has looked at different kinds of policies in place to see if there needs to be any kind of updating. It's just brought to my attention, you know, from several different individuals that we should kind of look over at the field trip policy. Now we can go, and the reason why I thought of bringing this forward to the regional committee, because we are going to be speaking about it in the Somerset committee to make sure that we have that cohesiveness. And, you know, usually it's the committee's pleasure to kind of look at it, see if there's any kind of update that needs to be done to the policy. There's a first reading and then typically a second reading, if I'm correct, Mr. Medeiros.
Yes.
That's how the procedure's been done in the past. I think reading over the policy several times, I think maybe we need to add a little something into some sort of kind of with the technology, with whether we have, some sort of, with the waivers and permission slips, making sure that we have phone numbers, contact information on hand, stuff like that, if anything that ever does occur. Just trying to be proactive instead of reactive on any kind of issues. I mean, we've never had a problem on field trips. We have great staff and great administration and takes pride in making sure our youngsters are safe and sound. But, you know, just kind of looking at things, like I said, just being proactive. Now, if we have the two boards discussing it, I don't know if it's better to have just maybe one board kind of discuss it than bring it to the regional board. We're all in like new grounds here, so if we have two boards discussing a policy, the policy could go shift two different ways, maybe. I don't know if it's something where we look at, you know, just one committee and then we bring it and say this is, but I think, you know, no matter what, we need to have that cohesiveness from both the K through 8 as well as the region.
Are you looking for something more specific?
I think so.
Back to language?
Yeah, I think the language just needs to be a little bit more specific. I think it's just very vague.
I think the process that's in place right now for the Washington field trip is great because you can call into a line to get updates. And is that still in place?
Yeah, that's a pretty unique trip to the extent that it's overnight, it's 5 days. I mean, this field trip setup is really, and I would question whether it's in the purview of the policy of the school board to the extent that it's left at the discretion of the administrators at the school. I mean, I think you can establish some parameters. That's what the policy should be. Specific steps that are taken for a field trip, whether it be elementary, middle school, or obviously for the region, high school level, have been typically left up to the administration at the school.
Available, right, for all the schools, and I think that would be utilized.
But again, that comes down to the administrators having that ability to do that. You know, someone who's supervising a field trip, I think, you know, we have to be careful, does not have the ability to use the one call system for that piece, and we wouldn't have that subgroup.
Wouldn't the permission slips have contact information?
They do. Yeah, I mean, that's stated there. I'm not opposed to making a change here. I mean, we had a high school issue with severe weather. Our students were at Six Flags in Springfield. Pretty unique circumstance, a tornado. I think everybody, including the governor, would say it was a pretty unique circumstance. And ironically, your crisis manual actually talks to tornadoes. It was something I pulled up in our crisis manual because you would think, how would you have that? And I probably maybe chuckled about it when it came through. One of the things that's unique about a field trip, though, is you're off-site. One of the things that our crisis manual and the Bristol County Sheriff's Office approved our crisis manual is number 7, do not board vehicles. So we have a tornado, our kids are in Springfield, parents want them to come home. And one of the crisis manual responses stamped by is do not board vehicles. Well, what option do you have? You're looking at some secure areas. So I just think I'm not opposed to addressing the policy. I'm not sure how specific any policy can be for field trips that's going to address every specific issue. I think you absolutely have to have a contact person. There needs to be communication. I think it's stated there. I think it's clear you need to know who those responsibilities are. I got the call on that from one individual on that field trip, and they wanted me to make the call. It's a tough judgment call for me to make. We have a ski trip, and the students are up in Vermont. I'm not so sure I'm the most appropriate one to be making a call on a safety issue if I'm down in Somerset. So we rely on the people who are responsible at the field trip. And you know, I think over the years where we've had certain instances, I think it's something for both boards. First reading is just that. If there's some suggestions or something you'd like me to look at from the high school perspective, we can do that. The intent of a school committee policy on field trips, though, is just that, kind of some general parameters, and then there's some more specific procedures. So I just
I don't want to hamstring the administrators that we're only focused on one school. But my suggestion would be we're going to address subcommittees. We had a policy subcommittee. I think if we want to look at the field trip policy, that we should make a decision as to whether we're going to have a policy subcommittee and then refer it to the policy subcommittee. It may be that some other school districts have much more elaborate field trip policies, or we may find that this is the standard, in which case it's fine. I think from the perspective, it's certainly true that the administrators at each individual school should have some flexibility in planning their field trips. On the other hand, there should be some overall policy guidelines to assure that kids are going to be safe and have adequate supervision and all of that. So my suggestion would be that we defer this issue until we have policies. We make a decision as to whether we're going to have an ongoing policy subcommittee and perhaps refer it to the subcommittee. Is that acceptable?
Yep.
All right, transportation reimbursement. Mr. Medeiros?
Yeah, this was an item I know there's some question in relation. I can tell you that we will receive transportation reimbursement. I think the promising piece that I provided for you, it looks like that
rate of reimbursement, which we anticipate to be about 50%. Looks like it may be as high as 58%, maybe even higher. It's very promising in relation to what's happening. I will say this, these are estimates at this stage. It is not really until September 30th at the latest when you submit the state report and that's all completed that you really know what your numbers are. I would say, generally speaking, it is promising. The numbers are not less than what we anticipated and or presented as we kind of move forward. And, you know, over the next 8 weeks, we'll have a much better idea specifically about what those numbers are as we complete that final report. I know Dr. Hemmen had lengthy discussions with Christine Lynch in relation to the DESC. There is no disputing the fact that both the Somerset Berkley Regional School District will in fact receive regional transportation reimbursement. The matter of is what the dollar amount is as we complete those reports. And the interim business manager, unfortunately, is not here tonight, will be here on the 11th. Has had discussions directly with Christine Lynch this week to verify that, in fact, begin and work on that process. And I think Dr. Hemmen at one time had offered to come down, but I mean, we have all the paperwork and documentation and we'll piece that together. And we'll be able to give you some specific details. In relation to that, I simply wanted to provide you with a real positive note in relation to the fact that it's not only on target, but it looks even more promising than we anticipated.
Very good. Any questions? All right, we'll move on to the next item. Collaboration with selectmen, finance committees, and school committees of Somerset and Berkeley. Mr. Kelly, you asked have this item on the agenda.
Yeah, I thought it might be helpful I can do it for Berkeley. Is that what we do is every month just update the board of selectmen or finance committee what's going on with the school. I know what happened with Somerset this year in regards to the health insurance and going back and forth. I don't know if that was because of communication or politics, but I always think it's helpful just once a month have one member of this board. I can go from Berkeley, just get in touch with the Berkeley Finance Committee, what's going on there, this is what we're doing with the school. Same thing with the selectmen and address any issues they may have with the school. I think it's always helpful that way. So going forward, if we need anything or they need anything, then we're all in a partnership. Because I think the school is one part of the community, but police, fire, and public safety and all that is another part. I think if we all work together, then we work together as a community. So I always think it's helpful if the school committee, on a regional end, the regular school committee meets pretty regularly once a month or so, just with 10, 20 minutes, pop into a selectmen's meeting, say, hey, how's it going? This is the update, this is what we're doing with the school. And then I think it gives everyone a process to be involved and if there's any problems along the way, you work it out. So I can do that for the Berkeley part of it. I can meet, you know, once a month, get on the selectmen's agenda and the finance committee's agenda, just show up and say, this is what we're working on, this is what's going on, and, you know, just have a face there as if they have any problems you need to address or if they have any issues they want to address.
I would think that would be welcome in Somerset. I don't think the ANF meets as regularly. It's more they ramp up as they get towards the budget process, but I think a periodic contact
to them and offer that someone can go and make a report. It certainly wouldn't hurt. I think that it might be a step in the right direction.
Yep,
I agree. All right, well, we have a member of the Berkley School Committee on our committee, and the idea is for that person to kind of act as liaison, and we also have two members of the Somerset School Committee, so maybe we could designate Mr. Kelly as our liaison to the Berkley Selectmen and Finance Committee, and do we have any volunteers to act as the liaison to the Somerset School Committee, Board of Selectmen and Finance Committee? Mrs. Gagliotti, if you have recently served on the Finance Committee and know the members well,
maybe
be good politics to have you as our liaison to those two committees. Legislative developments on teacher evaluation and health care. I think it would just be good to have us kind of updated on those two issues, which were major issues, one with the Department of Education and the other with the legislature. And I spoke to Mr. Medeiros about getting us copies of the new regulations from the Department of Education and a copy of the statute on healthcare, just so that people can review it to the extent that they feel they'd like to. Maybe we could defer that that issue for a meeting or two to give Mr. Maderis kind of an opportunity to perhaps prepare a short briefing on those two issues.
Is there also any way we could have, like, what that dollar figure would mean if we got the GIC and the legislature was passed, and we got what the savings for the town of Somerset, and what that would mean, obviously, for the school? Like, all of the town employees are in the same system here, right? The health insurance system.
I mean, I think the group, the health insurance group, needs to be part of that, too, in relation to the health insurance piece.
Well,
I mean, that was a discussion.
We're obligated for this year as part of the trust.
Right.
So we couldn't make any change for, at least for this year. But certainly, as we become aware of what the options are, we can talk more about that.
And as far as the evaluation piece, there is nothing that is on the horizon, with the exception of, I believe, 19 school districts that have agreed to be pilots in relation to regulations. I'll provide those regulations and kind of give an overview. It does this have impact on bargaining and so forth, but as far as September and rolling into this school year, really the word from the DESC and state, I'm jumping a little bit ahead, is begin planning, knowing that these regulations have been adopted, and kind of try to start moving in that direction as it relates to this, as best you can on a local level. So I'll be able to provide some more detail with the regs, but that's kind of a quick overview.
All right. Any other questions or comments on that issue? Public-private partnerships. Again, Mrs. Naraki asked that that item be put on the agenda, and she had a specific recommendation, so I think it might be wise to wait for the next meeting when she's present. She made reference to kind of a community foundation that exists in some communities. So unless anyone wants to talk about that tonight, maybe we ought to wait for her to be at our next meeting and discuss that issue. So I suggest we defer the public partnerships for tonight. That's acceptable. And move on to grant opportunities and grant writing. So I know that's a subject that's near and dear to your heart, Mr. Souza. But maybe the superintendent and Dr. Smith could tell us, kind of give us an overview of what we're doing already.
Shared responsibility. Dr. Smith handles a large portion of the grants that are currently obtained from the school department, and I'll have him speak to those specifically. We also have the director of special education who works, and actually some of the other directors as well, the business, obviously, business manager, interim, and even a director of technology and relation. But Brad, maybe just touch upon the general grants that are currently, that we're obtaining funds from.
Yes. Right now, the grants management piece for the regional district is fully operational for Somerset Berkley. And we're receiving allocations now for the regional school district. Our largest allocation is for special education, the special education entitlement for Somerset Berkley. We also have an allocation for Title I that'll be at the regional high school for reading support. And we also have the Title IIA, which is educator quality, that focuses on professional development. So those are the current grants. The other grants in effect, certainly the regional planning grant, which was approved earlier, and currently the MCAS academic support grant, which is in effect right now through the end of August, and we're funding an English language arts and math support program at the high school in August. ELA begins next week, and then a math academy in mid-August. So those grants are operational at the high school under the regional school district. So right now, there are probably five overarching grants for the regional school district.
In addition, because we just had an audit today, it raced to the top.
Right.
Some money.
Right, and that's also a key point.
And jobs.
Right. The Race to the Top grant is a four-year initiative through the department, and that was spearheaded by Superintendent Medeiros, working with the Somerset Teachers Association and in consult with the Somerset School Committee with Mrs. Carrera as the chair. That grant is a four-year grant, as I mentioned, the first year of $16,985. And I have been in contact with the department in terms of how do we coordinate that grant with the regional school district. So that's underway currently in terms of how do we actually segue the initial grant, which was through Somerset Public Schools, and then transition that with the regional school district. I think the goal would be to take the current plan, which has been approved, and then actually have a provision in there that would include collaboration between the regional school district and Somerset Public Schools. Now, I'm in the process of working on the year two proposal that will be submitted by September 30th. And that second year grant will include both Somerset Public Schools K-8 and then the regional school district. So we just have to work out the details. But I think the goal would be to really have a consolidated application and budget to service K-8, Somerset, and the regional school district, because the activities mutually inform each other. And I think the other thing too is that to have that collaboration between the two school districts is absolutely key because of the nature of the activities.
And I can tell you that Brad's understating his role in this piece. He's been in contact trying to help DESE with this new process and come up with these funds appropriately for the region and
right.
allocation. And we're trying to come up with what system works. He's referencing right at the top. And just to give you an example, so the region does not feel like they're being compromised in this process, even as we work out the monies. We have some pre-AP training
right.
that involves both high school and middle school staff. So it's right. not preventing us from some doing some training. I mean, that training's coming up in the next
well,
week.
Right, that training,
high school staff
right,
and middle school.
And the high school group will be participating in the training in the fall. And that will be under the auspices of the Race to the Top for Somerset and Somerset Berkley. So when I spoke with the department the other day, our liaison for Race to the Top, because they were also referencing how other regional school districts are actually collaborating with the K-8 districts in terms of one consolidated application, because it's really quite exciting to see some of the activities and the projects that are underway. You know, one of the key projects is alignment with the Common Core standards. One of the other projects is, you know, focusing on the pre-AP math training. That'll be a four-year initiative, and that will include both high school teachers and middle school teachers. So that's really what the goal is.
So is that grant in the range of the $16,000 to $17,000 each
year,
and it goes towards different aspects of that?
Well, the second year will be a larger grant, because essentially if you look at a four-year grant of $110,000,
okay.
that was the first year proposals were no more than 15%. And then the second, third, and the fourth year proposals. But actually, the state has required activities for all districts
okay.
that signed the initial memorandum of understanding. And then there are elective projects. We signed up for the pre-AP math training. When the superintendent had met with the Somerset Teachers Association, one of the priorities was focusing on math training. This is really high-level advanced math training at the middle school and at the high school, and they're really focusing on a consolidated team of grades 6 to 10. And I think one of the other goals is how we can also coordinate efforts with the K-8 Berkley as well. So I think that that has a lot of potential in terms of this. So there are both required projects. For example, the teacher evaluation framework, that's a required activity. The Common Core standards, the use of the education data warehouse, and the state interoperability framework. That's essentially a database where you report in real time data from the district. So we actually obtained received a grant initially to focus on that data management piece. So I think the goal will be to coordinate efforts between the two districts in one application. That's the goal.
And just have one question. And I guess in my mind, I keep going through this. There's actually three districts.
Mm-hmm.
There's Berkeley K-8, Somerset
right.
K-8, and the region. And I think it keeps getting lost. Like, Jay, when you're talking about the policies for field trips, you know, saying let's coordinate, well, there's
absolutely.
You know what I mean? And I think it keeps getting lost that, I mean, it's great that the Somerset K-8 program is benefiting from this, but the feeder program is this Berkeley K-8 as well coming into the system. So I think it keeps getting lost that we're a region or a separate district, but we keep talking about the Somerset K-8, and the Berkeley K-8 seems to get left out. It's the three completely different districts. So.
Well, I think.
And I think, I mean, Sky, I hear what you're saying. I guess from my central office perspective,
yeah.
Our shared responsibility of those two districts, though, and so I'm more careful to certainly comment in relation to what Superintendent Lynch is responsible for. I don't disagree. You're absolutely right. The same feeders programs work in the Race to the Top, for example, in the AP training. I had a conversation with Superintendent Lynch in relation to the fact that Berkeley receives Race to the Top monies small around because of the population, but in fact his willingness to amend the Berkeley Race to the Top if in fact it was looking to bring in some middle school Berkeley staff. So we've had that conversation, and so I can certainly accept responsibility. I think some of the times my focus and shared responsibility is on those two districts that we oversee, and I think it certainly isn't intentional to exclude the other entity. I agree.
But I think one of the other goals will be, certainly at the K-8 level for both districts, is that, for example, when we're looking at some of the work in grades 6, 7, and 8 especially, that would be the opportunity to coordinate efforts between the two districts, i.e. when we have our district professional development, one of the goals would be to have more K-8 coordination between the two districts as it segues into the high school. So that, I think, will evolve over time.
So, Mr. Pierce, Brad just kind of highlighted, at least for the group, and we can, as the year kind of goes on, provide some expenditures and kind of some activities. He's done professional development opportunities and kind of given updates. I think it'd be appropriate. And certainly we can look at other options as it relates to grant opportunities that the region can. I think the region's already done that through some incentives and things that are going to take place this year, too.
I think the cooperation on curriculum is very important. Both systems are feeding students to the high school, and it certainly makes sense to work together. That's a bigger bite than I'm prepared to bite off, at least in the first few months of our process, that's for sure. But I think the other aspect of the grants is that there is thinking that we should be trying to develop some process to go after private funding as well as public funding.
If I could,
sure.
Mr. Chairman, interrupt you. And Dr. Smith, I think you and the team does a great job finding a lot of grants, especially for, you know, the Somerset Berkley and Somerset District. But I think what we need to start looking at too is other kinds of grants, and this is something where we could talk about is bringing in a consultant that would write the grants for us that get paid through the grant. So it costs us $0, because in grants there's an administration charge to each grant, and sometimes it's 3%, could be up to 10%. It's depending on where it's coming from. But I mean, you know, especially like working with the Workforce Investment Board, you know, which is, it's a regional kind of piece through Bristol County, DPH, Justice Department, foundation money, not other nonprofits, private entities that set up foundations, other kind of foundations. I think we're missing the boat. I mean, I think in Somerset Berkeley is a unique kind of district, and I think we can tailor it to receive some sort of monies to enhance different kinds of program, and maybe it help with some enrichment kind of classes, after school programming, all those different things that, you know, we don't need to be budgeting for, that we can go out and receive funds for. So I'm thinking, you know, maybe to start looking into some sort of, you know, consultant that would, people would come in and they write the grant for us, and they just, I mean, it costs us nothing. If we receive it, they get paid. If we don't receive it, they don't get paid. And it's a way of really bringing a lot more money into the district. And, I mean, something, you know, George, I mean, you mentioned, maybe this is time where we start collaborating with Berkley. I mean, we talked about collaboration with the selectmen. Maybe it's something we collaborate with the town of Berkley, with their selectmen, with the town of Somerset and their selectmen, with the two towns. And it could be an educational slash town grant. There's many different ways of tailoring grants. And some people say, oh, well, you know, Somerset or even Berkeley, you know what, oh, you know, we're too high up in the, you know, the middle class, or, you know, we make too much money and stuff like that. But you gotta remember, I mean, we have high unemployment right now, okay, in the communities. Crime, you know, there is some crime that goes on in our communities, and there's stats that show that. I mean, it might not be a high, you know, high crime, a high risk kind of crime, but there's still different kind of data that we can really look at and grasp. And I don't want to put more work on Dr. Smith and the administration team. I'm thinking more so of bringing in maybe a consultant. I mean, they pay for themselves. I mean, working in a nonprofit where, you know, my budget is over $1 million and 100% of it is grant funded. So I'm very familiar with grants, and
I think that I have experience with grant writing as well. I think, unfortunately, a lot of the grants that are out there are for the urban settings, the urban environments. Unfortunately, and it's far few between that you can find for areas like Somerset, like Berkley. If you can find somebody who's gonna, because the amount of work that goes into a grant, if you can find somebody who's willing to do that with the chance that they may not get paid for that work, I'd be all for that. I mean, that'd be really great for us. I don't know anybody out there who can do that.
My concern is making sure that we have the right things to write grants for. Mm-hmm. I've written grants for. And we don't want to, we've run into difficulty, as you know, criticized for supplementing our budget with grants that don't come on an annual basis, and then you have to go to the town. So maybe it's something that some community looks at.
But you're not talking about hiring personnel with that. You're talking about after school activities?
I mean, I'm not looking where, there's certain things, like what Julie just said, you don't want to just write a grant to write a grant to receive money, because sometimes it doesn't fall into your mission.
Well, I think that's very specific. Some of them are so restrictive.
Some of them are, and I'm just going to disagree with you, Liz, where you say, well, Somerset doesn't fall into the category because it's a lot of urban. There is a lot of money out there, and especially a lot of the foundation money doesn't really go into the urban setting. It goes into setting on the outskirts of an urban community, and that's where we fall into. So if we can tie in, especially like the Bristol Workforce Investment Board, I mean, they're bringing in millions and millions of dollars, and we're not tying into that as much as we should be. You know, last year we did receive a couple of kids, you know, through the BCPC program, you know, to hire. But I mean, even hiring youth in the summertime, doing other things, collaborating with the recreation department, with DPW, with the library. There's other different avenues, not just the school department, where there's a multitude of different collaborations that we can start tying into. And that's where the money is. It's collaborations. And right now, it's the four walls here and very little kind of collaboration in the sense of grant money, okay? We definitely collaborate. We open up our schools to the public. It's a public school. But when it comes to the money piece of it, it's very little collaboration. So what I'm thinking is we need to start looking forward in that, because that's where, a lot of money's hidden. And it's just, it's a person that's out there that's willing to look for it, to find it, and then to write.
Do you know people that consult?
Yeah, I mean, I've touched the Fall River Police Department, for instance, they have a person that writes grants, and if they get it, she gets paid. If they don't get it, she gets none.
Okay, well, you know, so I might just want to put a proposal together and have, I mean, I think we've all before, if you can get grant money for free, it's kind of a no-brainer, I think.
Well, it's true, except that you have to be prepared to devote the resources within the school system.
Absolutely.
Making the grant work, and very often grants are designed to introduce a program with the expectation that the school department is going to continue the program and pick up the cost going forward in the future. But I certainly think that it's something that we ought to be thinking of, perhaps when we are setting up our subcommittees, and we also hear further from Mrs. Naraki about what she has in mind in terms of public-private partnerships that we can. And perhaps if there's some information about the kinds of private grant funding that other school systems within the state may have received, that might be interesting information to receive. Certainly in terms of, do we have kind of a work transition program at the high school? I thought that there was a program at one time where seniors were at a reduced
We did that at one time. We had, it was an internship piece through the business department.
Right.
That's been reduced dramatically. We didn't have the numbers, but it was through within the business department. I mean, I'm not opposed to any of those pieces too. So if someone has a contact and wants one of us to follow up with something, but by all means provide me the contact, and then
Do you ever have grant inquiries come originating from staff? For example, a curriculum coordinator may come up with it. It doesn't happen that often.
I mean, that might be very occasional, maybe in terms of a private grant, but most of the grants are really channeled through the Department of Education, and there are different categories of grants, and there's a range of requests for proposals. Some of them are highly competitive, and others are entitlement or allocation type grants. So there's a wide range of grants, and certainly, you know, we've accessed competitive grants in the past, and you know, we've been able to, you know, secure funding through that. So it really depends on the nature and scope of the grant, and it depends really on the eligibility, because every grant does have an eligibility guideline. And you know, so I think you just have to really look at it in a holistic way and look at it grant by grant, depending on, you know, what needs are addressed, you know, for the district.
And just to add, I mean, what we would need too, I mean, if we're going out for private funding and different things like that, we would need some kind of goals and some scope of where do we want to add on to. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, you can just open up the floodgates and you can find all this kind of money, and then do you want to say you want to tailor it to what's out there, or do you want to, I mean, I could just top of my head, I mean, Lori's here, you know, with the television, and she works extremely hard, and that's a collaboration with the town, with public access, where that's something where we could look at to be bringing in, you know, more equipment and different things for television and for the students, but also collaborating with the town and doing more public access. I mean, that's just off the top of my head. Because I'm just looking at Laurie over there.
Well, that's perhaps something that a subcommittee could put on the table. Mm-hmm. Now, there are other interesting areas we're thinking in terms of expanding programs with a particular department.
And I'm still prepared to let the MSBA pick up a large chunk of our TV studio, so I don't want to let them off the hook and up when that new building comes online either. Oh, I don't disagree. Yeah, but they've already got us listed on the proposed, so I think we should get it consistent.
No, but there are some other interesting programs. I don't want to kind of get off on a tangent here, but in terms of the study that I've shown to some people, one of the areas that I find very, very interesting is a high school that undertook to include an aerobic exercise program in their phys ed department, and they've shown, studies have shown that this kind of aerobic exercise really sharpens students' ability to focus and concentrate. So this particular high school has actually scheduled students for these kinds of aerobic exercise phys ed sessions immediately prior to the tougher courses that they're taking, maybe advanced math, or even with students at a lower achievement level that are having difficulty focusing in a particular program. So if we were thinking of incorporating that kind of thing into our phys ed program, perhaps we could go out searching for a way to find grants that would permit us to purchase that kind of equipment on the premise that we are undertaking, you know, this, which is kind of cutting edge, I think, in terms of phys ed and how it can really have a direct impact on student performance. And there are some that have done this and have demonstrated that it can. So that's the kind of thing that I'm thinking of in terms of maybe going to the manufacturers of this kind of equipment and saying, we'd like to do this, and we'll study it, and we'll give you the information so that maybe it will be a way for you to market your equipment going forward. And at the same time, and it's the kind of equipment that we can acquire and use and be able to move to the new high school, because that's not the kind of equipment that SBA is going to reimburse us for. So that's just one example that I was thinking in terms of. So I believe that covers our agenda items. Now, we do have a meeting scheduled for August 11th, but I know at least one member is not available. Are you unavailable all of that week or just on that particular day?
I do have one week.
Okay.
But I will come in that week. That day is just out of the question for me on the 11th. But I won't come in any.
You said the 11th is not good for me?
No. Is there a building committee meeting scheduled that week?
No, we do not have anybody.
How about the 10th? The 9th?
I'm going to do this. I'm not available all that week, right?
No, I'm available the 11th.
The 2. 2 people can't make it.
And the following week wasn't any better. Is that correct? Wasn't that discussion?
I was the only person, I think, who couldn't make it on the following week, correct?
I can't make it on the 18th.
It would not be uncommon. I recognize we're starting a regional board. Typically, we meet once a month.
In the
summer months, Somerset does that as well. We have a meeting scheduled on the 25th. I mean, I'm looking at what the agenda would be on the 11th. Beside my
the one issue that maybe may require us to meet is if they're able to move quickly on the contract for design services, they may want us to give final approval to that contract sometime in the next few weeks. I had indicated to Mr. Fenstermaker that we were scheduled to meet on the 11th, so that if they were able to move the process along that quickly, we'd be able to consider the contract.
Can we just meet on the 11th and just put one agenda item on, or a couple agenda items on, and have a quick meeting?
That's fine.
Or
meet at the 10th. If everyone else can make the 10th, then make it the 10th.
Yeah.
Is that a better day for you?
Well, that whole week is terrible, but I'll be here the 10th. The 11th, I won't.
I mean, you could have two members, you know, seven-member board, you could have a five-member board and still accomplish that task as long as people are comfortable with their.
Because it's going to be impacting or tied into a budget, there has to be representation from Berkeley. That's part of the agreement.
That can be either 10th or 11th, any day that.
All right, then why don't we move our meeting from the 11th to the 10th?
Okay.
6:30.
That was easy.
And does anyone have anything else? Not, the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
And a motion made by Ms. White, seconded by Mrs. Ferrer to adjourn. All those in favor?
Meeting time.
Opposed? Unanimous.